Now, I wanted to say a few words about this prison industrial complex that has this increasingly privileged place within the global economy, and the way in which it serves to support the persistence of racism, but also how it has become a gendering apparatus. And I don't think we think about the fact that there are prisons for men and there are prisons for women, right? Now, what about people who are gender non-conforming? Because I think we've learned over the last period that there are more than two genders. So what happens to them? Where do they go? Or where does a transgender woman get sent? Or a transgender man get sent? Or someone get sent? Or someone who doesn't necessarily identify as male or female? Of course, the prisons do, they rely on the old notions of biology, that, you know, biology has the answers for everything. And so they inspect people's genitals. And it's based on the genitalia that they get classified as a certain gender and therefore sent to certain prisons. And then, of course, there are problems with violence. And people often argue, well, if you send a transgender woman to a men's prisons because she has male genitalia, she's going to be subject to rape. Because we think, that rape is something that somehow male prisoners begin to do once they go to prison. We don't ask ourselves why. You know, where does that come from? We don't ask ourselves about the extent to which the institution itself promotes that violence, needs that violence, generates that sexual violence in order for the system to work. And then we see it happen in Abu Ghraib, and we see it happen in Guantanamo, and we express such shock that this is not the way America is supposed to operate. But if we look at what happens on a daily routine in the domestic prisons in this country, we see that violence, we see that sexual coercion. And of course, women have been especially hurt by these developments. The prison industrial complex has brought in women from the global south, indigenous women in numbers that are so disproportionate into this global prison industrial complex. If you go to Australia, who do you think you'll discover in disproportionate numbers in the prisons there, in the women's prisons especially? The prison industrial complex has become so big and powerful that it works to perpetuate itself. It's self-perpetuating. The raw materials are immigrant youth and youth of color throughout the world. So if one visits a prison in Australia or France, the Netherlands, Italy, Sweden, one sees young people who come from communities that we in the US designate as communities of color. You see indigenous people. And so race matters a great deal throughout the world now. This is something that the US has basically offered to the world, a way of managing their social problems by refusing to confront them, by putting people who have these problems behind bars. And we can't deny that there are people in prison who've done horrible, hurtful things to others. But these aren't the majority of prisoners. And there are many people in the free world who've done horrible, hurtful things. And there are many reasons why people engage in violence, sometimes out of malice, sometimes out of mental illness, sometimes out of self-defense. Many women who are in prison for having committed violent acts have killed in desperation in order to extricate themselves from a violent, intimate relationship. But whatever people have been convicted of, does it make sense to house hundreds, sometimes thousands of people together or separately in isolation cells, deprive them of contact with their families, deprive them of education, deprive them of health care, deprive them of home, and then assume that this is going to be rehabilitation?